So when I was 14 years old, I went out into a long walk in a meadow in the spring, 40 years ago, this spring, and I walked through beautiful, basically, lilies coming up. And I grew up in the far frozen north of Canada. And so it took a little extra time for spring to arrive. But when it arrived, it was a miracle. And I just loved going down with these plants. I'm like, how does this plant know how to grow? How does it come out of the ground like that? Wow! You know, 14-year-old tripped out nerd. Hadn't touched a computer. There were no computers in our town, right? There was a big thing where you put punch cards in up in the college, but I couldn't get at my hands on that. So I, at that moment, decided I'm going to work on the mystery of how life not only emerges from the ground, but how it started from scratch. And what does that mean? That means you have like a glass of water that you've added something called lipids, which is like soap bubbles, and amino acids like your Braggs, you know, Braggs amino acids, and these things called nucleotides, you know, and a bunch of other stuff, and stir it up and like say to that glass of water, okay, organize yourself into a living cell, you know. As long as you try all your life looking at that glass of water, you may line up a lot of glasses of water, it's not gonna happen. So this is a really cool nerd problem to work on. How did it happen? How did molecules decide to assemble themselves, or somehow got driven to be assembled and come alive, you know? And so when I was 14, I did a thought experiment. Like, okay, how do you solve these problems? You can't solve them with your mental mind. This is the great untold secret of science. Great science is never done through logic. Great science is done through vision and magic. Great science is done when you get an outsider like Albert Einstein. He was a dude working at the patent office, right? He couldn't get into school. And his mind was really non-conventional. And he would write these patents by night, and then he'd go for really strong coffee in Switzerland, because they had it, and then he would dream up the new physics, right? This guy, complete outsider, complete non-conformist, and look at his hair later in life, right? He's like a hippie of the first order, stuck his tongue out at cameras and whatnot. So Einstein was how you do science. You just are trippy. And so this is how great science is done. And it's done by weird outsiders who are generalists, who are crossing fields, who are fearlessly taking, I'll take a piece from there and a piece from there and a piece from here and do it, you know. It's not done by the bench chemist or the technician doing their thing to get more and more papers out. It's never done by those people. It's done by really weird people. So I'm going to tell you a story of very weird science. So when I was 14 years old, it's like, okay, I'm going to work on the origin of life. And how do I do that? Well, I don't know chemistry, right? I still don't know chemistry, but that's another story. And what happens? Oh, you just open yourself. Open myself, projected forward. I'm working on the origin of life to the day I die. This is the big project. And then suddenly in my mind, just like literally hovering in front of my brow, was this molecular machine moving. Like, oh, holy shit, where'd this come from? Oh, okay, well, it's come from somewhere. I don't have to know, you know. And there was stuff moving and writhing. And like, okay, I'm trying to figure out what it's doing. And then I asked it a question. I figure, you know, it's not talking to me. I'll ask it something, you know. I said, how did you make a copy of yourself? And it said, it's not possible. You figure it out. You go and figure it out. Not the way you think that I made the copy of myself. And so that became my challenge for 40 years. So when I discovered computers, I used computers to try to figure out how to make things that would grow in software. It's called artificial life. Has anybody played artificial life games? Right? I wrote a bunch of those. And then I went to work for NASA in the 90s. And NASA gave us a ton of money to build a simulator that could run zillions of computers to simulate parts of space missions. So we did I designed the first full human mission reference design to take people to asteroids, you know, these rotating space potatoes, you know, to land people on asteroids. I did that for them. Because why? Because I'm a weird outsider. I wasn't a civil servant. You know, I couldn't get fired, actually. So I did these mission designs. I did rover designs. I did asteroid visiting. And then recently, a design to put a balloon around an asteroid and suck all its juices off, its minerals, its water, to allow us to settle the solar system. Because that was the second crazy idea I had in 1978 when I was in high school. I said, okay, we're going to work on how life began, but how does life go forward? Forward. Because the Earth is a womb. She's mother, right? She made us. But because of gravity pulling things down, complex life can't get out. So one day the Earth's going to run out of steam. It's actually past middle age now. It's got a bunch of bald spots, you know. And sometimes in my journeys, I meet her. I meet Gaia or her representative and ask her these questions. And she told me once, get going. Get going on the program. You guys are it. You are my reproductive organs. So the previous speaker showed us how to be sexual, right? Wasn't that juicy? Isn't that great? We are all collectively Gaia's reproductive organ. Think about that, right? So I asked her, I said, well, yeah, well, if we're your reproductive organ, we're really trashing the place, you know. It's a beautiful orgy, but we're cutting down all the green, you know. We're winnowing the oceans of all the life. And she said to me, I don't mind as long as you do the act of reproducing me. Give me a new world to settle, or make me a world. Because you're the last shot. You're the only shot I've got. So that's a little bit of the spirit in this thing. Because there is a spirit in this thing, this quest. Because every time I get a new chemical model, I present it to this energy. I say, look at this. Look at this self-assembly. Look at this process. And the energy pats me on the head. You know, nice try, monkey. Let me show you the next stage. So you can get review in these weird places, unexpected places, if you start out that way. So, to the present day, what's happening today? Well, Wednesday morning, getting packed for LiB, I got the email, the fateful email, after 40 years of thinking about this, after working on chemical models for six, with my collaborator, David Diemer from UC Santa Cruz, after lab work, after reaching out to the whole science community, presenting the first phase of our model, the paper was accepted for publication. And for, who's a science geek in the audience? Do you know how hard it is to get a general theory in publication? Do you know? It's frickin' fucking hard, I'll tell you. They have this thing called peer review. Have you ever gone through peer review? If you're married, you probably go through peer review. Peer review, okay? So, the final epiphany to this model happened last year in a place called the Pilbara. Anybody from Western Australia or Eastern Australia here? No Australians? So, I'm going to show you one other thing. So how do we go about figuring out how life started? If you were to do that, shout it out. What would you do? Even if it's a crazy idea, what would you do to figure out how life began? And I'll repeat your answers. Go to volcanoes, okay? Stromatolites. Ask Jesus, okay? Good one.
Make up a story.
What was that? Dig up a quarry.
That's funny. Huh? That's funny.
That was the funniest thing in the world. I love that. Perfect scene.
Go down to the bottom of the ocean.
Yeah, that was actually a great answer.
Smoke mushrooms? I don't know if I smoked them. T Terrence never tried that. Okay, could work. So someone over here said stromatolite. So this is a stromatolite. So I don't know if you can see it. Probably can't.
How old is that?
But see those little ridges on this thing? This is the oldest proven incontrovertible evidence for life on Earth, right here. And I picked it up in Australia last year, last July, on an expedition with the geologists who know their shit. You know, I don't know the geology either. And these ridges are laid down by our ancestors, by what are called microbial mats. And what are microbial mats? They're huge communal units of living cells that get along, right? They get along and they can do amazing things. And they did the most amazing thing for us. They cleaned our world up for us. They gave us our oxygen. They gave us a complex multicellular bodies. For 3 billion years, these guys worked on this project. You know, what thanks do they get? You know, well, they get to inhabit our teeth, for example. So plaque is a microbial mat, right? Pond scum, things like that. They get to inhabit a beautiful world that they made for us. So in a sense, they are God, the microbial mat. And if you study James Lovelock, he talks about Gaia theory. We're now going to be able to extend Gaia theory because we think we found out basically Gaia's plaque. So this is old, 3.5 billion years old. And it literally hasn't been changed. So it's from a place which is a great big rock slab. And on underneath that slab is a 70 kilometer deep keel, like a keel of a ship. And it's called the Pilbara Craton. And a piece of it got busted off and is now in South Africa. And there's a piece in Australia embedded into Australia. And this thing is the ship of state, of the state of life. It's been pushed around and shoved around by continents and subductions and whatnot. It's never gotten subducted. It never got sucked into anything. It was stable. It was like the most stable thing. The Pilbara Craton is older than a lot of stars, for God's sakes. And riding on it were the oldest signs of life on Earth, just for us to pick up on a roadside, just to pick up. So Gaia, or Cosmo Gaia, is pretty cool, isn't she? That she gave us some evidence to look at, like our ancestors. So there's a couple of other things here. Always something in the poke. This is a piece of the seafloor, and there's little striations in here. And those are individual tides going in and out, 30-foot tides, 4 billion years ago. And they deposited this layer, 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 layer. That's how planets are built. That's how everything is built, layer upon layer. And the last piece is something very rare. This is the nucleated core of a Tumbayana stromatolite. This is the very beginning of the first of that little microbial mat, and then starts growing out and layering down sediments so that it's preserved for us to find. So that's looks like a little pea, but you could grind it up and have in your coffee or your tea. But it's the nucleated core. So onwards. Can you guys see the screens?
Yep.
Can you see the image on the screen?
Yes, sir.
So what this is one piece of artwork. It's a visionary, scientific, explanatory piece of artwork that will be in Scientific American in a couple of months, 2-3 months. It is now emblazoned across this article for a journal called Life. And it's one sort of painting to show how life may have started, so it communicates it. Now, can you see that the blue thing on the top? The blue thing on the top represents your bathtub. When you take a bath, you know, what happens to you? You sit in the bathtub, and there's a bunch of soap, which makes bubbles, and there's a bunch of sort of scum everywhere that comes off your body, right? And then the bathtub drains down, and as it's draining down, all the bubbles are accumulating by the plug, right? You get out of the bathtub, and then your partner comes by and says, "Oh, you left this horrible mess, you know, clean it up." I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He said, "There's this ring of crud around the bathtub, especially after coming from LiB." Well, it turns out this is our model, bathtub-based life. But it's not a bathtub that humans have made, it's a bathtub in nature. And have any of you been to Yellowstone or Bumpus Hell or these incredible roiling pots of pools, right? You've seen those? They're different colors, they're different heats. They have life in them now. But these pools are magic places. They're like nature's bathtubs, nature's jacuzzis. And we go out there with our instruments and we find a pool and we put our stuff in it. So we took an asteroid that's as old as the Earth, scraped stuff off of it. It's the same age as the Earth, and we put it into one of these pools, and immediately this beautiful film of basically soap bubbles formed. And we go, whoa, that's a big part of life coming from the sky. It's something called lipids, and it's every wall, all your cell walls are lipids. You are lipid, walking pieces of lipid beauty, all of you. You're mostly made out of that. So we identified, oh, this is what's going on. And then we waited a while and we saw that the pool is drying down. The lipids went to the edge of the pool and made a bathtub ring. And Dave, this is Dave Diemer, 20 years ago said, this is amazing. And he went back to his lab and he made a pool in the lab, put his lipids in, he put basically things like Bragg's amino acids in there. He put basically building blocks of RNA with his lipid, dried it down, and he found that the RNA lines up in between these layers of dried bathtub ring layers. And they watched as the building blocks of RNA went tick, 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 and formed a string of RNA. Wow. And then they rehydrated or put water back in and dried it down again, and they were longer. Tick, 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 longer. 200 base pairs. Like, we can make RNA with this process that would have existed on the early Earth. We can make RNA from these pieces. Then another lab got excited and they did it with basically amino acids, and they were making proteins this way. It's like, whoa, cycling little hydrothermal pools. It could be the origin pool. This is how we could have started. But the chemists do experiments in the really narrow focus, right? One of them did the protein part. One of them did the nucleic acid part. One of them does like the little itty bitty part over here. It takes a crazy person like me to come in having this passion for 40 years of working on this. Dave took me in, patted me on the head, mentored me, gave me this many papers to read. I kid you not. I went to conference after conference and I absorbed the entire field. It's what you have to do if you're going to synthesize it. I'm a crazy unknown person. He trained me. I absorbed the whole origin of life field. And then one day, sitting after Vipassana yoga and breath work alone, the vision came. This was December 30th, 2013. I went into what I call an endogenous state or an endo trip. You know what endogenous means? Endo, the term that's going around, it means you make it yourself, endogenous. And when you're little, when you're 8 or 9 or 10 years old, if you ever experienced this, maybe some of you still do, if you had a real stimulating day, like all these talks and whatever, and you try to go to sleep at night, you close your eyes and there's all this color going. Everybody experienced that? There's like flashes and everything. Do you know what that is? That's, I believe, is endogenous DMT in your system. This is why little kids have an incredible power of imagination. They can lay imagination on anything. They can fly the airplane, you know, and it's a real Battle of Britain to them. They're like movie makers, and they're using their endogenous chemical system to go into spaces. And I used to love this when I was 9 or 10, and I decided it was the coolest place to be, so I never turned it off. I found any way that I could to keep that thing going, the endo thing going. And that's why all my drawings from junior high school are weird machines. They're bizarre worlds, because I lived in those worlds, because you're bored at school, right? How many of you sort of live in these fanciful, bizarre worlds a lot of the time? Right? You're driving yourself into your own trip, you know. Of course, there's many other trips you can have. I had discussions with Terrence about this. Terrence called it the on-the-natch way, and he wasn't convinced you could do it. But the way Terrence was when he wasn't stoned, to me, was a trip. So I hold it to you and to Terrence that he could do it on the natch. Because in a sense, you have to be able to bring it to do it naturally on the natch. So here I was doing my Kriya Yoga, and I had loaded all this stuff into my mind, and I closed my eyes, and suddenly I saw it. I saw the pond. I saw the RNA getting trapped between the layers, and I saw the pond filling up, and bubbles came off. And you can see on the left is the layers of the bathtub rain. And as the pond is filling, the bubbles are budding off in their trillions, and they're containing RNA, random bits of RNA. And then I saw them going through, and some of them are popping. Some of them are being shaken apart. There's like a trillion of them. But some of them have accidentally a bunch of RNA that stabilizes them, that holds them together. And watch what happens after that happens. The pool dries down. The pool dries down, and look at the bottom there. You see those little dots there? They form a crowded little community of bubbles, like in the bottom of your bathtub. We call that the gel, the hydrogel. And I realized in a flash that this is the patterning of the cycle of life itself. You dry down and you become the seed, and you get packaged up, and you're your DNA and everything like that. Then the rain falls, and you survive this big rainfall event. If you land in the right place after rainfall, the soil then is drying down, it's not so wet, and you bloom like the plants that I saw when I was a kid in the spring. This is a cycle of life. You can do this at home, pretty much. You can make these things happen at home. And I realized this is a system that could pattern the emergence of life. And I could answer the question of the little bundle of molecules that said, figure out how I made a copy of myself, right? Challenging me. And my little 14-year-old brain was like, impossible, because you're a machine, and a machine can't make a copy of itself, because it needs a bigger machine to make a copy of a smaller machine. Ah, it's impossible. This is the machine that can do it. Why? Because it's a network. It's not one thing. It's a collection of things. So I'll give you one example. So the bubbles are cycling around. They're going through the gel phase. They're wobbling together. They're sharing stuff. Then they dry down. All their crap is forced out, all their waste products. They don't have Johnny on the spots, but they need some way to get that out. And all that's left is the longest molecules. Then those molecules make copies of themselves. You go through the whole thing again. The molecules keep getting longer and longer and having more and more jobs. And they have different jobs. So in that gel at the bottom, one little protocell, we call these protocells, magically happens to have the right molecule to make a pigment, to make a dye. You know, when you go to the seashore and you collect kelp, it has that brown color. That's really healthy stuff for you, by the way. That's a dye that's made by kelp to protect the whole kelp community. And I realized if this happens back then, when you have ultraviolet rays coming down that are just baking you, one little protocell does the magic of making a dye. The dye comes out of it, floats up to the top of the gel, and protects everybody. Everybody benefits from an innovation from one. Isn't that amazing? And I realized, holy shit, this is a whole new way of thinking of how we began. We began as a collaborative communal one. not as individual cells fighting tooth and claw as the, I wouldn't call them neo-Darwinists, but I would say that the Darwinists in economics and politics would have us, like the Donald Trumps of the day. You gotta fight, 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 right? It may be, and I posit to you, that we started as a collaborative unit like this. So I went rushing to Dave with this. You know, this, I'm just the visionary guy. You know, he's the chemist, 50 years in this game. I said, Dave, look at this. A gel will form in our instrument. And he looked at that and he said, that will be selected for. That's the highest praise or okayness that you can get from a scientist in the field. That will be selected for. He immediately saw it. Those things clumped together are more likely to survive than an individual floating around on its own, which will get popped. So we needed to have community at the beginning. It's a total revolutionary thought in all of chemistry, chemistry into biology, into self-organization, into the very way that we think about life, that you have to have community, you have to have sharing. Now, where does competition come in? You know, you still see lions on the Serengeti grabbing the gazelle, and you still see we're eating animals all the time, we're eating plants all the time. So I said, well, you know, isn't it just all things eating other things, and it's like so gross and horrible, and we're doing the worst job because we're eating the whole planet? So I put this question to the energy next time I saw her. I said, okay, let me show you the state of the model. So I basically ran an endo trip while in her presence. I said, watch these protocells moving around, getting more and more complex. I got the pat on the head, like, nice try. And she said, are you sitting down? Because what I'm going to show you is going to blow you apart. I said, I'm lying down. Okay, so I just stand to receive, or I'm lying down, horizontally standing to receive. And suddenly my precious model gets rotated like this. A slice gets taken out of it. Now I'm seeing it in 2D. So instead of seeing a circle this way, I'm seeing a 2D surface. And there's trillions of these protocells coming into being and going away. Trillions of them, patterns, weaves and weaves of these protocells. And they said, watch me. So down came a grid onto my precious little evolving protocells that aren't alive yet. I go, what did you just do to my protocells? They're all smashed by this grid. And she said, wait for it. And up coming through one little piece of grid segment was a wiggling, struggling protocell that came up, looked around, and started to reproduce. And I said, I'd noticed it had these little shiny jewels in it. And those jewels were its polymers evolved to survive at that layer of the grid. And then it filled the grid space. And then another grid came smashing down on my precious new jewels. And I was like, what did you just do again? Let's just wait for it. And they came back up. And then she said to me, what did you see? What do you see? I said, I see sacrifice everywhere. I see most of them don't make it, but one does, and it gifts what it learned, what it evolved to the next level. And then it's challenged again. And then she grabbed my shirt collar. Have you ever had the ineffable grab your shirt collar?
Only
I think
once.
She just said, grab my shirt collar. Listen, you monkey. Listen, and you listen good. You listen good. You know, that is my process that made you. That is my process that made you. Darwin, your man, got it right, but you've got it wrong in one very important thing. I'm going to tell you this once and only once. This whole survival of the fittest thing, it's freaking destroying your world, and it's destroying you, and it's taking us away from the miracle that is unfolded for you and for life. You must get over this. You must stop using that language. You've gotten that wrong. Survival of the fittest. Get over it. So I then fell back. Well, I was already lying down, but I fell back lying down. Like two huge revelations. This is how it did it. And this is a whole new way to see evolution. It's a gifting process and a sacrificing process to give to the next level. And we are the recipients of the greatest gift of all. We have hearts, we have minds, we're freaking incredible tunnel skills. We can just like do anything with matter. right? We're the gift receivers of all this 4 billion years, all this magic and hard work. We are the recipients of those gifts. And basically, you know, the eyes of the cosmos are possibly on us. It's like this, it's like reality TV, you know, for them. You know, there's Big Daddy Cosmos is like, let's tune in today to see how the almost successful experiment is doing. You know, well, they're at a festival, you know, they're sitting in this round thing, and they're actually talking about this, you know, they're actually talking about the grand experiment that they are. Does this make sense to you guys? So when you're in a state, an altered state, I put this forward to you, as Terrence and I always used to try to figure out, like, well, these incredible things you see in any altered state of any kind, with any medicine, human medicine, plant medicine, presence medicine, stillness medicine, you get these worlds coming to you. Are those real? Does anybody believe those are real worlds? They feel so real, right? But where are they? How are they made? So I came up with another theory, and this is the theory that will not go to peer review. Would you like to hear it?
Yes. Yeah.
Would you like to hear it? The greatest gift that we were given, and how much time do I have? Do I have a watch? Huh? Do I have enough time?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
I got 2:30, I don't know. Oh my God, 25 minutes. Okay, you won't shut me up. So here we are. We may have figured out how we began. That's powerful information. You remember when those guys on Apollo 8 were flying around the moon, and one of them saw the Earth rising behind the moon, and he said, quick, grab the camera, and they stuck it against the triangular window, and they shot the Earth rise from the moon. Remember that? From orbiting. Remember that one? That picture ended up on the front of the whole Earth catalog, right? It totally blew people away. You see that picture everywhere because it showed our home. It showed our beautiful Gaian biological bolus of a home from outside, and how beautiful it is and how delicate it is and all that. That was good stuff, right? That was worth all the fighter pilots and the nerds and the Cold War mania, right, to get that one image. Well, I believe that the first team that makes a gel in the lab, what's called a progenote gel, that makes this gel and notices as they're cycling through their little dishes and everything, suddenly one of the postdocs comes in, or probably the overworked undergraduate, you know, who's done the 500 iterations, comes in and says, it's growing. It's distinctly growing. But then it shrunk last night. The gel went down, and then the postdoc, because, you know, of course, professors don't do any real work, right? So the postdoc.